Hey, what's up guys? It's Joe here with Deranged. So if you're watching this video, you probably already know that there are a ton of new people getting into the side-by-side and off-road industry for the first time. You're possibly one of them. So I wanted to take some time in this video to go over a few important things to remember if you're getting into the side-by-side industry or into a side-by-side or off-road vehicle for the first time. The biggest reason I wanted to address this topic is there's been some incidences recently in places in Utah and other parts around the country that have just been not the right look for the side-by-side or UTV industry. And basically, I think it just comes from inexperience and people not understanding what is right and wrong. Let me say this up front, I'm not perfect. I am experienced with off-roading and offering you my experience. What I do want to do a little bit different with this video though, is I want you guys to share your thoughts in the comments down below. If you have thoughts on what I'm saying, not just what I'm saying, but if you have tips, tricks, all that kind of stuff for people who are getting into the off-road industry for the first time, share it in the comments down below so we can kind of use this as a learning deal for you and me and for everyone else. So with that said, let's jump into the video.
Easy peasy, man.
So the first thing that I want to address is safety. It's something that we should all think about. I'm not going to address cages and helmets and stuff like that. More along the lines of driving safely. How do you drive safely if you're getting into a side-by-side for the first time? And I'm going to start with hand signals. Why am I starting with hand signals? Well, you're not the only one on the trail, and it's your job to keep you safe, but it also helps to keep other people safe as well. So what are hand signals? You've likely seen them before, but I'll go over them again real quick. First, if you're the lead car and there is one car behind you, hold up a one to let the person coming your way know that there is another person coming your way. If there's two cars behind you, hold up the two, three, for three, up to five. If there's more than five cars behind you, hold up just hold up the five, and each car in the back holds up a five until there's less than five coming. If there are no cars behind you or you are the trail car, hold up a fist to let them know. It's not some sort of power signal. It's just letting people know that there's nobody else behind you. You're the last car. The next thing I want to talk about is corners. And what I mean by corners is blind corners. When you're riding just about anywhere, especially in the mountains, you're going to come across blind corner. A blind corner is just a corner that you can't see around. If you're going around a blind corner, make sure you slow down and you pay attention to which lane you are in. There are way too many accidents that happen because somebody is going too fast around a blind corner, or they're in the wrong lane or wrong side of the road going around a blind corner. If you want to be safe when you're cornering or approaching blind corners, then choose the right lane, choose the right speed. The next thing, and I feel it's really important, especially with the rigs that people are choosing nowadays. People are choosing to go with high horsepower rigs for their first rigs. I have a few friends that have done it, and I know other people have done it as well. And maybe if I was in the right financial situation, I might have done it with my first rig. But with that said, there's a ton of people getting into high horsepower rigs as their first rig. It is super important for you to spend the time getting to know your rig before you use the power that you have. If this is your first side-by-side and it's a 200 horsepower machine, make sure you understand how to use that power before you do use that power. You'll get yourself into a lot of trouble real quick if you're going faster than you're able to drive. What I mean by that, you might outrun your talent. Your machine might go a little bit quicker than you're capable of handling. So get to know your machine, spend some time getting to know it, understand how it reacts and responds to the situations that you get it into. With that said, I'll say this as well, and everybody, I feel like the dealer should tell you this when you buy it. Don't do a donut unless you know how to do a donut. If you plan to do a donut in your rig, plan to be upside down if you don't know how to do them. They're pretty simple and they're a lot of fun. The biggest key is you've got to hold on to the throttle while you're doing a donut and know your terrain that you're going into. If you let off the throttle while you're in a donut and you're still in a turn, you're going to be on your lid, and nobody wants that. So I would say with donuts, just stay away from them until you know your rig and how it's going to respond, and until you understand the concept of doing a donut. Okay, the next thing I want to address is trail etiquette. What is trail etiquette? Well, there's a couple things that are involved in it. Number one is understanding where you're at. If you're in an off-road park that's private and it is a go-anywhere park, do whatever you want, as long as that's within the rules of the off-road park. Follow the rules and be, I guess, the best way to say it, it's a good example to those around you. If you're in a national forest or state land or trust land or whatever it is, stay on the trail. If you go off the trail, that gives cause for that trail to be taken away from the rest of us. So if you are on an international forest area on state trust land, stay on the trail. That does not mean that you can't pull just off to the side or off to the shoulder, because you need to do that when you want to park and chat, have lunch, whatever else it is. You want to be able to do that. That does, however, mean that you can't pull off into a nice green valley or a nice marsh and do donuts and brodies and, you know, all that kind of crap. Stay on the trail. Don't mess it up for the rest of us. Now, I know I'm going to offend some people with this one, and I apologize if I do, but it is what it is. Drinking and driving is drinking and driving, whether you're in your side-by-side, on a quad, in your car, on the freeway, or anything else. I don't have the statistics offhand. I'll look them up and see if I could put them in the video down here below or whatever. But I'm sure the majority of accidents that happen when off-roading have alcohol involved. So don't drink and drive. Now, I know there are some of you who are going to want to drink while you're on your trip. Choose the right time to do it. Plan to do it in the evening when you're done riding. Believe it or not, you can have a ton of fun off-roading in your side-by-side or other off-road vehicle without alcohol involved. With that said, I'm not your mom, nor is anybody else. You make the decision that's right for you, but understand, drinking and driving is drinking and driving. So the last thing on trail etiquette is to help others. I've had a winch on previous rigs of mine, and I know Garrett and Dave both have had winches on their rigs as well. Only once did I use my winch for me. The other five or six times that I used it was to help other people get out of the situation that they're in. And I know Dave and Garrett have both had similar experiences with the winches on their rigs. Help others, and they will help others as well. The off-road industry, side-by-sides as well, is a real tight-knit group, and we need to continue that tradition of helping each other when we're out on the road. Okay, the last thing I want to address, and I say it at the end of every video, and that is pack out what you pack in. I learned when I was in Boy Scouts, I wasn't a good Boy Scout and only got as far as first class, maybe tenderfoot. I don't even remember. That's how good of a Boy Scout I was. But we learned the principle of leave no trace. And leaving no trace means somebody could come up behind you and not even know that you were there. So it is super important as you're out enjoying the off-road, enjoying nature, mudding, in the mountains, at the dunes, wherever you are, it is super important for you to pick up after yourself and make sure you pack out what you pack in. Oftentimes, because there are lazy people and bad people in this world, you'll have to pick up for other people as well. I highly recommend, we don't sell them, maybe we should, I highly recommend getting a sacket or something similar and attaching it to your rig so you have a place to put your trash available at all times. That way you can pick up, like I said, for yourself, or you can pick up for others. Another good place that usually happens for me, because I don't personally have a sacket, is just to put the trash at the feet in the back of your rig if you have a four-seater. That's what I tend to do, because oftentimes the kids aren't with me. So why is it so important that you pack out what you pack in? It's really, really simple. If the place gets overrun with trash that you're riding, or garbage, or whatever else, then we won't have that place to ride anymore. A perfect example is I live in Arizona, and up near Prescott, there's an entire section of forest that they shut down this year. For the next couple years, I think it's to 2023 if I remember right, but that section of forest is shut down and there is no camping or off-roading allowed in that section because people have been so bad at picking up after themselves. Taking a sofa out to camp and then leaving the sofa when they're done. Taking a barbecue out to camp and then leaving the barbecue when they're done. If you want to continue to ride, make sure you pick up after yourself, you pack out what you pack in, and you don't leave a trace that you were behind. That kind of goes back to staying on the trail as well. If there's a nice, beautiful marsh, it's supposed to be a nice, beautiful marsh. Leave it there. Unless you're in a park that allows it, then do what you want to do. But don't go off trail when you're in national forest land or state trust land or other land like it. So that's it for this one, guys. Leave your thoughts in the comments below. If you have other things to share down below or experiences that you'd like to share with others, then definitely share it down below. We want to have a discussion on this and kind of, get your feedback and share feedback down below as well. So share your thoughts down there as well. If you're looking for parts or accessories for your side-by-side or anything else, definitely check out derangedoffroad.com. We have parts and accessories there. We have apparel and whatnot as well. Another thing you may want to do is check out our new Pro XP build that we have started. So it is not going to be a big crazy build, but we did pick up a Pro XP recently, 4-seater. We're in the process of getting that thing built out. Excited about where it's going. And excited for that machine. So check out that video either up above or in the description down below. With that said, guys, that's it for this one. Ride safe, pack out what you pack in, and we'll see you on the next one.